Good morning. It's Bill Dubois, and welcome to Sam Hall's Bible Ministry. And we're going to be in Daniel chapter 11 today. Now, oh boy. See, I got a little bit of sun in me there, Sam. So we're going to be doing Daniel chapter 11, and it's going to be titled North and South Battles. And it's going to be very, very, very interesting. A lot is going to happen in these first 45 chapters, 45 verses. There's 45 verses in this particular book. But it's very, very, very interesting. I read it last night. As a matter of fact, I read it twice last night. It's such a lot of stuff going on. And I found that it really makes you start to think of what's going on over these many years that this is being done. But anyway, with that being said, we're going to be starting chapter 11, verse 1 here in a little bit, and ask that you have your Bibles ready, open, to follow along with us. And we appreciate it that you're with us today on this study, because Daniel chapter 11 is going to be a barn burner. I mean, a real barn burner. There's going to be a lot of information being passed out over these next 43 verses, not the question, 45 verses. The question is how many are we going to get done in this study today?
All 50 of them.
Okay. Anyway, with that being said, we're getting ready to start again. God bless you all, and here we go. See you on the backside.
And Daniel chapter 11, moving right along. Verse 1, let me read that. It actually, you could, like I said last time, you could end it with 10, but let me read 11:1. Says, also in the first year of Darius the Mede, even I stood to confirm and to strengthen him. So that ending chapter 10, going into 11, we're going to be getting into a lot of what it says over here, a lot of north and south battles in this area. And of course, guess what land is right in the middle of all this? A little old Israel, specifically Jerusalem, the capital, the holy city, the city of God.
It seems like it's more focused on Jerusalem itself.
It is Jerusalem itself, yes. One aspect of it, before we start reading, and I want to read about the first 23, 24 verses of this. It's a lot of history. I'm not going to go into detail. I've got the details here. But to get to the meaty part, it starts about verse 25, about 35, really. Remember the metallic image that Daniel saw back several chapters back that Nebuchadnezzar had. We've gone from Nebuchadnezzar in the gold, the Medes and the Persians in the silver, the arms across here, the head and the silver, and now then we're moving on down. And this chapter 11 covers... the first part of it covers around 13 years, but the whole thing is in Daniel's future. All this is going to be in Daniel's future.
Right.
Some of it we've seen looking back. The latter part of it we are going to be looking forward to. So when we get to verse 36 and 36 on to 45, it's all in our future too, the future of us.
Yep.
It was in Daniel's future, and then the whole thing, you sum it up, well, there's about 125 years that goes on here, because he goes from the silver into the bronze, the brass belly area, which would be old Alexander the Great. If you remember, when Alexander the Great died, he had four generals. It didn't go to his immediate family. It went to his military family. It went to his four generals. Well, two of them really stand out in this, and that's the one who took the Egyptian part, Ptolemy, and the one who took the Syrian part, the Seleucid dynasty. And there's revolving Antiochus and Epiphanes and Antiochus III that go along with Antiochus Epiphanes V, and they're all mentioned in this, not by name, but it's who they are, it's referring to with other scripture, Maccabees and stuff like that.
That's what I was going to ask you, because after reading it twice last night, it just really says north, south. North kicks south butt, south kicks north butt.
Right.
They bribe each other with women.
Back
but it doesn't say what territory it is.
Yeah. It's let's see, if you have the map, it's the Egyptian area down south. Mm-hmm. That would be Egypt. South Egypt, mm-hmm. North Syrian land, mm-hmm. And on into Russia, if you want to add later on, Ezekiel 38, 39, 37, 38, 39, it talks about that too a little bit too.
Yeah.
Russia's going to get involved, but quite a bit later. So let's get started now. I want to read just out of the Bible. Open your Bible, Daniel 11, verse 2. It says, the conflict between the north and south. Now will I show thee the truth. Behold, there shall stand up yet three kings in Persia, and the fourth shall be far richer than they all, and by his strength, through his riches, he shall stir up all against the realm of Grecia. And a mighty king, and that came about, there was 33, and then the fourth one was a very wealthy one, Ahasuerus. If you want to read Esther and Nehemiah, we've already talked about that. Xerxes Ahasuerus over there. He was very, very wealthy, very well-to-do, had a lot of treasures in his house. And the Lord actually has him help fund the Israel going back, okay? Mm-hmm. So, three, it says, and a mighty king shall stand up, and that shall rule with great dominion, and do according to his will. This would be Alexander the Great. He's the beginning there. And when he shall stand up, his kingdom shall be broken and shall be divided toward the four winds of heaven, and not to his posterity, nor according to his dominion, which he ruled, for his kingdom shall be plucked up even for others beside these. So if you look back to 9:22, it talks about his four generals taking over, it gives the list and everything else. And so we're going to concentrate on the two, the ones that went north, the ones that went south.
Okay? Correct.
His four generals. Two specific in this chapter.
Correct.
5 and 6 says, and the kings of the south shall be strong. The king of the south shall be strong, and one of his princes, Ptolemy of Egypt, and he shall be strong above him and have dominion. His dominion shall be a great dominion. This is Ptolemy the first, Soter, S-O-T-E-R, from Alexander the Great. He took over, and then his next lineage, very quickly after that, they set up the kingdom, and they rule because Alexander's rule was already established. This was part of his land that he already had established. So they take over, and it's their particular quarter of the kingdom. See, this is where we're going with this.
Correct.
And 6 says, in the end of the year shall they join themselves together, for the king's daughter of the south shall come to the king of the north to make an agreement. So they're going to be having associates going on here. But she shall not retain the power of the arm, neither shall he stand, nor his arm, but she shall be given up, and they that brought her, and he that begat her, and he that strengthened her in these times. Well, it's interesting here, and I've read different commentations, and they all agree that Daniel was given a little bit of what we would call a soap opera today.
Yeah.
This is a soap opera going on here,
yep.
But it's part of the vision that Daniel has, this vision, because it all plays a part as to who's who, where they are, when they're there, mm-hmm. how they rule, how they don't rule, how their dominion is diminished, how their dominion overflows, and then who comes against them later on, and this, and who they battle, and who is who's who. We're going to even get into Rome and their navy here is going to be mentioned. But let me read you just a little bit of commentation on 5 and 6, what I wrote here. The king of the south, this is verses 5 and 6, the king of the south of what? That's the south of Palestine, south of Israel. Israel, they were south of there, so that would be Egypt. So the general who took Egypt after Alexander the Great dies is Ptolemy, P-T-O-L-O-M-Y, and his family, and the north, the line of the Seleucid Empire. And forgive me if I mispronounce that, S-E-L-E-U-C-I-D, Seleucid Empire, after Alexander the Great dies. And here it's about 250 B.C. So you'll see that all of this is into Daniel's future too, that he's talking about. This prince here is Seleucus the First Nicator. He was born in 311 B.C. and a general under Alexander. He was one of Alexander's generals. He left and became the ruler of the Seleucid Empire in Syria and the Babylon area, where Daniel is right now, where Daniel has been a captive in exile for all these years, about 70 years now, and just west of him is the Syrian area. So this is that empire that this man is ruling. And so the king of the south, now Ptolemy II, Philadelphus, he enters into this alliance with the north, Antiochus II Theos. And in sealing the deal, in ancient times, the daughter of the lesser king would be sent to marry the greater king. So Berenice was sent, this was his daughter, was sent as the wife of Antiochus II Theos, and he was already married to Laodice when he and he divorced her. Well, she gets PO'd, Laodice does. She gets PO'd and she poisons Antiochus, Berenice, and their child, and she sets up her own son, Seleucus II, Callinicus, who becomes the king of the north. So Daniel gets to see all this soap opera going on. Well, it's very important who these people are, because later on, one of the really nasty one is going to be the guy that says, is going to be the one that demands the worship, you know, so sure enough. Come in. How are you, sir?
Pretty good.
Yeah, well, good. Watch all the wires there.
I know you pointed out. Meaty.
Bill and myself, that's it today. Yeah.
What the heck?
Just us two, yeah. Oh, you have a new sheet, don't you?
Yeah. New year.
Right, sure enough, yeah. I saw that new paper and I didn't think about it this morning. Got out of habit. Take it away.
Yeah. Everybody out of habit.
Yeah. It's easy to slip, isn't it? I'm glad to see you out and about, man.
Thank you.
Good to see you, James.
Yeah, you're looking good. Sure enough. Thank the Lord for it.
Good to see you again, sir.
Yeah. I'll try to remember that next week when I'm in there and just mark it on there.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. So this is part of the thank God that man he's tough.
Yeah.
Oh boy, his wife just passed away. He's on oxygen. So yeah. Berenice's brother now. And let's read seven.
I'm just not even going to read. I'm just going to listen to you.
Okay. All right. So let me read 7 and 9. So it says, but a branch out of the roots shall one of be in one of his states, his estate, his kingdom, which shall come up with an army and shall enter into the fortress of the king of the north and shall deal against him and shall prevail and shall also carry captives into Egypt, their gods, with their princes and with their precious vessels in silver and gold, and he shall continue more years than the king of the north. So the king of the south shall come into his kingdom, and he shall return into his own lands. Well, Ezekiel 30 tells about this. Now, this is a few years after Alexander the Great dies. The dominant world power, Alexander the Great, one of the greatest military minds ever. The brass in the belly here.
Right.
Now then, Bill and me ask you, refresh our memories. After the brass belly, what comes? You got gold, silver, brass.
Clay?
Iron and clay. The iron first.
Iron first.
And who's iron? Rome. Yes, so we're inching closer here, okay? So we got this chapter in 12, so we got to throw Rome in there. Because that's
yeah, well, yeah, I think I read Rome in 12.
So you got all this power struggling internally and externally going on. You got the kingdoms that are set up, and without Alexander being there going, it's me, it's all, I mean, he's a young man, young ruler, but God had set him up to be the ruler of the world, and he was dominant. Fast moving, quick thinking, military mind like nobody else had ever seen, and boom, with 35,000 guys. That's pretty tough. So he's gone now, and you have all this power struggle going on inside the kingdoms and, of course, outside the kingdoms. And when you have internal struggles, the exterior knows they're not firm inside. That would be a good time to go take them. Okay, Washington, perk up. So 7:9 tells us that Berenice's brother, Ptolemy III, Evergetes, I think is his name, of Egypt in 246 BC, And now as the king of Egypt, and that's the south, that's the land of the south. Anytime we say north and south, remember we're talking about God sees Israel and Jerusalem, especially, as the center of the earth. So anything north, the landmass, the actual geographical landmass north of Israel, north of Jerusalem, south would be south of Israel, okay? So he invades into the Syria and avenges his sister by killing Laodice. And he seizes the Syrian's treasure and returns to Egypt. And he took 4,000 talents of gold, 40,000 talents of silver, and 2,500 idols. So he literally fulfilled this scripture. Daniel got to see this intertwined with all the battles going on, with all the skirmishes going on, internally and externally. He sees inside this, God, this would make a movie. Somebody needs to make a movie.
Yeah, man, I'm just sitting here. I got questions, man.
Daniel, it should be called Daniel 11, the saga. You know. So here we go. Let's read 10 through 12. Read. Your 7 through 9 would tell you a little bit more about it, but go ahead and read 10, 11, and 12, and 13, if you would.
Okay. 10 goes, however, the sons of the king of the north will assemble a mighty army that will advance like a flood and carry the battle as far as the enemy's fortress. Page 11. Then in a rage, the king of the south will rally against the vast forces assembled by the king of the north and will defeat them. 12. After the enemy army is swept away, the king of the south will be filled with pride and will execute many thousands of his enemies. But his success will be short-lived. And 13, a few years later, the king of the north will return with a fully equipped army far greater than before.
Okay. So those verses that you just read talked about a 13 to maybe 14-year span, those verses right there. Well, what was happening during that time, bless Israel's heart, is part of their national vicious cycle of making poor choices. Bad choices. They would align themselves with the north. The north would be at the weakest. The south would invade. They'd come through Jerusalem, through Israel, kill and plunder and take, go on to the south, take Syria. A few years later, Syria would regain the strength. Then at that time, Israel would be going, well, they didn't help us last time. Let's align with Egypt this time. Egypt would now be weak. Israel is aligned with Egypt, the south. Here comes Syria, or the from the Babylonian realm, the Syrian army, the Seleucid Empire, plunder Israel again. They're right in the middle. It's like a really tight band-aid that's just getting tighter and tighter and about to break. This is part of Israel's heritage and legacy that they're doing all this time back and forth, ping pong, with these battles going on here. Each time Israel makes poor decisions, they're plundered, they're killed, they're taken away, they're doing whatever else. Okay, this is Israel's right in the middle.
Oh, so Israel is kind of like collateral damage here.
Collateral / targeted.
Okay.
All this time, none of them really appreciate the Jews.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Anyway, that was to 13. Now we're going through these quickly because the meat of this, the gist of this chapter is later on. But I do want to fill in some of the blanks here. 14 says, we'll read 14 through 19. So now we're going to go to Ptolemy. Another Ptolemy, let's see, why Daniel is told this part of the vision is because it concerns his land. That's what I wrote on there. So many Israelites died during this time period. Much suffering is inflicted from the north and the south kings and their in the glorious land. So let's read that. It's going to talk about the glorious land. 14 says, and in those times there shall be many stand up against the king of the south, that's Egypt. Also the robbers of thy people shall exalt themselves to establish the vision, but they shall fall. Many die in Israel. Like I said, they're making bad decisions all this time with all these conflicts going on. So the king of the north shall come in 15 and cast up a mount and take the most fenced cities. And the arms of the south shall not withstand. In other words, the north will be dominant again. Neither his chosen people shall stand. Shall there be any strength to withstand? Now, let me ask you, class, Bill, myself, is Israel looking up at this time going, God of heaven, help us? Or are they just looking up a little bit to the north and then down south? That's all they're looking. They're all looking up to heaven.
Yeah, they're sitting down. Who do we side with this time?
Well, remember what we've read over and over in Isaiah. Don't make alliances with these people because they're not your friends. They're your enemies. Fascinating. In little old Daniel,
we learn
all of what's going on yesteryear and tomorrow. Yep. It's right before us right here, if you just know what it's talking about.
Yeah.
16 says, but he that cometh against him shall do according to his own will, and none shall stand before him, and he shall stand in the glorious land which his hand shall by his hand shall be consumed. So here is Israel again, right in the middle, and you've got these kings battling back and forth. Now, folks, when it comes to this one, Antiochus the Fourth Epiphanes, he's the one that is so absolute unrighteous, so disgraceful. He is the picture of the coming Antichrist. And he is the one that's going to stand up in the temple. He removes all of the oblations. He causes Israel to stop anything and everything in their temple. He sets up some say Zeus, some say Jupiter. It's an idol. And he offers swine's broth and swine's blood on the temple, which is what Daniel calls, and Matthew refers back to, Jesus in Matthew 24 refers back to. Remember the prophecy of Daniel, have understanding, is the abomination of desolation. That God says, that's not going to happen. Hold on just a minute, that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
And so when he does that, that's the marking of the Antichrist. Well, a good old boy called the Hammer, Mattathias of the Maccabees, if you want to read some of their writings, pretty spot on. It's not in the book, but he's going to talk about them here in a minute. It says the Israelites have a little help. They get help and a little help. Well, that's who they're talking about, the Maccabees. And some boy stands up and says, mm-mm, that's not going to happen anymore. And they shut him down. They assassinate him. So it's fascinating.
More. Give me more.
Let me read to 19 and then I'll read you my notes. 17 says, so now the 17 starts us off about 196, 198 BC, 198, 196 BC. In BC, you have to start with a bigger number, come down. He shall also set his face to enter with the strength of his whole kingdom and upright ones with him. Thus shall he do, and he shall give him the daughter of the women, corrupting her, but he shall not stand on his side, neither be for him. So Antiochus his treaty with Egypt and gives his daughter Cleopatra. Along about this time is when Miss Cleopatra comes to Ptolemy Epiphanes. Isn't that interesting? You ever seen the movie with Liz Taylor? This is who she's supposed to be
playing. Cleopatra,
portraying.
Yeah.
Cleopatra almost broke the company there to make this movie. But the thing is, there was an actual daughter, Cleopatra. Well, lo and behold, if the real one of the Bible here doesn't, she was sent there to be a spy. Okay, she was sent by her king to be a spy down to the south, and she actually sides with her husband. You know, she was sent there to marry him, so she sides with her husband and betrays her kingdom. So this is where all that war breaks out with Cleopatra, Egypt and Syria and all that. It was an actual happening. So after this shall he turn his face unto the isles, these outlying areas there. And this is when the Greek isles there, and shall take away, but a prince for his own behalf shall cause the reproach. Well, guess who this is talking about? Rome. But a prince for his own behalf shall cause the reproach offered by him to cease without his own reproach. He shall cause it to turn upon him. So you get a shameful retreat from this Antiochus the Third. He's going to try to do this again. He's going to try this domination tactic again, but he's met by an overwhelming Roman navy. And right. They come up against him and they go, we don't think so. In fact, this little boy, we're going to fix and get to him. Well, I'm calling my name here in these next notes. He says, I'm seeing what's going on over here in this area of the geography. You remember, this is over in Asia, and Rome's in Europe. So he sees what's going on. He hears tell about all this conflict going on for year after year after year. Israel's right in the middle. And then the one who finally gets a good foothold starts spreading out a little bit. And they're inching closer and inching closer out in the Mediterranean, out in Greece, out in these other areas. And finally, Rome goes, they're getting a little bit close.
Yeah, could I, let me read 18.
Yeah, do it, sure.
After this, he will turn his attention to the coastland and conquer many, many cities. But a commander from another land will put an end to his insolence and cause him to retreat in shame.
Sure, right, read 19 too. This is the rise of Rome here.
He will take refuge in his own fortress, but will stumble and fall and be seen no more.
Right. Sure enough, let me read you that. The many Israelites died during this time. This is 14 and 19 here, that we just read. In this glorious land, Israel, which was promised to Abraham by God and those who come after Abraham. Verses 15 and 16 is the victory of Antiochus the Great of Syria over Egypt. There was much horrific suffering in Israel during this time. So this time now, we've skipped to about 125 years of being fulfilled to accurate detail. Daniel is saying this spot on well into his future. Now this is, he's an old man, he's 90 years old, given this vision, and he is seeing what's going to happen in the next 13 years, and it did. Mm-hmm. Then he's seeing what's going to happen in the next over a quarter century. A century and a quarter, 125 years of different battles going on, bigger battles going on, and then yet another continent coming in, the tax people. These things they must come to be. And class, again, we're reading a lot of stuff, and I'm not reading all of my notes. I got four full pages of notes here. I'm filling in a little bit of the blanks. The gist of it is, just like Bill said, what the angel told Daniel, don't get caught up in it. Don't get bogged down in, how many years BC, 190, and Cleopatra, who was her, what kind of a dress did she, don't worry about all that stuff. Don't get bogged down. Just understand that it's happened in our past. It was going to happen in Daniel's future, and it did. We can look back and read history books about this. But the Bible, in this one chapter, tells the whole story.
I know.
It tells the whole story in detail.
This is kind of like the prelude to Revelation.
It sure is. You have to understand Daniel and then read Revelation. After you read Revelation, go back and read Daniel.
Well, we've gone through Revelation a couple of times, and then now after reading this,
it's like filling the blanks.
Right.
When, where, and who.
Right.
Yep, sure enough. So these 125 accurate detail by Daniel due to him being an Israelite and a believer in the God of Israel. And he's, of course, over heaven and the universe. It's his. So 17, there's around 198 to 195 BC when Antiochus the Great made a treaty with Egypt and gave his daughter, like we said, Cleopatra, along about 190 BC, to spy on Ptolemy the Fifth Epiphanes and to marry him. So Cleopatra ends up supporting her husband and this prince for his own behalf. And the commander from another land would be Rome. So we're told about two different huge happenings there going on from the Syrian to Egypt, and from Egypt skirmishes, and then the spreading out up northwest into that area in the past the Mediterranean Sea. And then Rome hears about it and goes, hold on a minute. So all this is fascinating going on. Read 22 through 24.
Before him, great armies will be swept away, including a covenant prince. With deceitful promises, he will make various allies. He will become strong despite having only a handful of followers. Without warning, he will enter the richest areas of the land, and he will distribute among his followers and the plunder and the wealth of the rich. Something his predecessors had never done. He will plot to overthrow strongholds, but this will last for only a short while.
Okay, this is the one that we've been introduced to back a few chapters back. This is the Antiochus the Fourth Epiphanes. This, you take all of them, they weren't as bad as this guy. This guy went way out on a limb to throw his fist up to God and to thumb up his fist to the Israelites and their customs and the God of Israel and everything else. This guy was at that time, you could probably say Satan on earth at that time. He was just nasty. He was just a blasphemer. So this is Antiochus Epiphanes, the king of Syria, the little horn of Daniel 8. Remember when we said this, and it's rather a little horn, this is who it's talking about. That's why I said when we read those previous chapters, just stay tuned. the more you read, the more you're going to understand. And that's why I don't elaborate so much per chapter. Read the next chapters, then you remember back.
Correct.
And it fills in the blanks. So see how he takes over, not by proper lineage. Notice that he was not in line.
He was not in line.
He was not in line. He thwarts his way through there, and he weasels his way in there, kills, steals, destroys, whatever else, and with smooth words and flattery. And then he hates the Jewish people in all their ways. And the prince of the covenant, probably the Jewish high priest here, Onias the Third, who Antiochus had assassinated by his defecting brother, Menelaus, in 170 BC at the request of Antiochus. So you're talking about even going in and just desecrating, killing, whatever, it doesn't matter. As long as they're in power, that's what they want.
Right.
You sound like the Clintons and the Obamas today, don't you? So Antiochus Epiphanes of the Old Testament is the man of sin in the New Testament. Remember that. Antiochus the Fourth of Epiphanes in Daniel 8, 9, 10, 8, and 11 is a perfect picture on a lesser scale of what is coming. Now, we weren't there at that time in 170 BC. But it happened. You can look back and it happened. It's in history books. It's in the Bible, which is the best history book.
You can see as you progress through the chapter, it doesn't get any better.
No, it's getting terrible. It's worse.
It's getting worse.
It's getting worse. That's why I want to go ahead and get to 36. So here we have this old boy, Antiochus. He's been introduced already, but now then this is where this fills in the blanks for where he is. So he spread the riches and gains loyalty, money, and influence. This is how he does it. See, he's not even supposed to be on the throne.
Right.
Gee, that sounds like Haman and Hitler and the coming Antichrist. Sure enough.
Yep.
25 through 28 says, in other words, hey, he fulfills what some of the Proverbs says. He's buying favor with others. He doesn't deserve loyalty. He doesn't deserve their friendship. He doesn't deserve their respect and service. You know, him being king on the throne, he's buying their loyalty.
The thing is that he's fulfilling prophecy. But he doesn't even know it.
This is true. Couldn't care less.
Right.
But Daniel's going, and this old boy, I mean, can you imagine? Put yourself there again. We've been watching The Chosen. Put yourself in that time. Put yourself way back then. The cobblestones, the donkeys, the carts, the people over the taskmasters whipping the Jews on. Put yourself in this situation, and then pull yourself out to Daniel. He's seeing this vision going on and going, oh my goodness. First of all, the first few verses of this, he's going, ooh, people are messed up. These families are messed up, just like Abraham's family was messed up. Mm-hmm. You know, they put the deus in dysfunctional, you know? And so here he is seeing all this. 25 says, and he shall stir up his power and his courage against the king of the south with a great army, and the king of the south shall be stirred up in battle with a very great and mighty army. But he shall not stand, for they shall forecast devices against him. So you got some of these Egyptians to fight with him now. He's schmoozing his way into bigger and better dominance. And that's how so many politicians do it today. I'll give you this if you help me out here, you know. 26 says, yea, they that feed on the portion of his meat shall destroy him, and his army shall overflow, and many shall fall down slain. False treaties, lies, deceitfulness, whatever it takes for this man to get into and stay in power and be dominant is what he's going to do. Doesn't care about anything else. This is what happens.
Me, 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 me.
And so 27 says, and both these kings' hearts shall be to do mischief. Now that's a sad statement right there, folks. They're leading a huge army themselves, but they also have a population to rule over. But notice what it says about their heart. It says both of their hearts are to do mischief. That's sad. If you've been keeping up with the Proverbs study, that's just a sad thing. Where's your heart? Their heart shall be to do evil. 27, it's who they are, who really... what drives them, what comes out of their innermost being. And they shall speak lies at one table, but it shall not prosper, for yet the end shall be at the appointed time. Well, that's a good encouragement for Daniel at the time and for us to look back on today and look forward to, is this is all on God's timetable. So you have these unreliable peace talks, Bill. You've got people sitting around, and they're sitting here. Imagine me sitting here and the other guy sitting over there, and we're shaking our heads and we're grinning at each other and, oh, yes, and we have another cup of tea together, and then end up we stand up and we shake and we bow to each other and we walk away, and you're thinking, every word that I just said to him was a complete lie. And he's going, every word that I just said to him was a complete lie. Well, watch what happens. It's a bad, it's not only bad for them, it's real bad for Israel. Watch this. Then shall he return into his land with great riches, and his heart shall be against who? The Holy Covenant. And he shall do exploits and return to his own land. Well, what is he going to do right there at the time? On the way back, he takes his anger out. It wasn't a good meeting. So he takes his anger out on who? Israel.
Okay, but it's kind of like the punching bag of the Middle
East. Absolutely. They're the punching bag of the Middle East. You got that right. Think of it that way. Israel is the punching bag of the Middle East. You're right. Now then, this king here of the south, Egypt, Ptolemy the sixth Philometor, who Antiochus the fourth Epiphanes, finally overtook him. And Ptolemy's own counselors plotted against him. We just read that in 25. His own counselors, his own people around his wise people's table. Again, go back to Proverbs. Who do you have around you? Who do you have telling you advice? Are they foolish or are they wise? They ensure his defeat by telling him wrong.
Right.
So he's swept away by Antiochus' army here. So these two sit at a table together and lie. No good outcome to this meeting, but all part of the God's time. It says it right there. We just read it. His timeline. And
it was just a formality.
It was one of them things. And on the way back to Syria from Egypt, Antiochus kills 80,000 Jews, took 40,000 prisoners as slaves, and plunders the Jewish temple in 169 BC. So it must have been a bad meeting. He must have been really ticked off there. I mean, that was just about, I don't know if the hors d'oeuvres were wrong, or if it wasn't right wine, or his shoes hurt, or something, but something went really bad.
Neither one of them had planned on.
They were not going to honor their words, no.
Right.
Look what it says, both their hearts do mischief. Mm-hmm. So, can you really sit across the table from somebody today in politics or church and look in their eyes and grin and shake their hands and say, oh, God bless you, and then walk away going, just a load full of lies. Yikes. Man's heart. Wow. So read 29 and 30 there.
Okie dokie. Then at the appointed time, he will once again invade the south. But this time, the result will be different. For warships from the western coastlines will scare him off, and he will withdraw and return home, but he will vent his anger against the people of the Holy Covenant and reward those who forsake the covenant.
There you go. Line the punching back up again.
Yep.
See, this Daniel is saying all this and seeing all this. Why? Because it concerns his land. He's over here. He's well taken care of. He's in the palace. Okay. He's 90 years old. He's done everything he needs to do. God's been taking care of him. But here's his heart over in Jerusalem.
Right.
He's seeing this going to happen to his people. He's following. He's going, Lord God, just turn their hearts to you. They're trusting in Ptolemy, the Antiochus. They're looking for over here. They're looking over there, but they're not looking up.
Right.
So you got the Antiochus' second campaign against Egypt. He is met by the Roman navy now. But notice here in what you just read, 29:30, some of the Israelites betray each other. Notice what it said just then. They give information, intelligence. So Antiochus has. So from these who forsake the Holy Covenant, if you want to go over to Matthew 24:10, Jesus himself is telling about the end days. Read Matthew 24. It's a marvelous chapter. One of my favorite chapters out of the whole Bible is Matthew 24 and 25, 24 especially. Matthew 24:10 says, but in those days, my people, they're going to betray each other. They're going to lie about each other and on each other. Well, it's happening right here because it just said, at the end of 30, Daniel 11:30, it says, when he's returning and have intelligence with them, that forsake the holy covenant. Well, who is that? These people, they see him defile the temple, and they go in there, well, we don't have a problem with that. Our God hasn't been helping us. We don't even know if he's still on the throne. We don't even know if there is a God. After all this, we don't even know if there is a God.
Yeah.
They're putting their trust in military might. This is what the Antichrist is going to do at the end time. People are going to go, he doesn't serve the same gods that we serve. He doesn't serve the God of this, that, and the other. He serves a mighty military power. This is strange to us. These are strange gods. Well, who has the biggest tanks and the biggest guns? This is what the Antichrist is going to put his power in.
Yep.
Oh, people, you got to wake up and get it. Matthew 24:10 says that. Jesus himself said it. You're going to betray each other. It happened in World War II all the time. There's one thing in Germany that is so true today. A German cannot trust another German.
Well, look what they did. Look what Hitler did. He made treaties with Stalin. And that was just...
You're a bad dude. That was Joseph Stalin.
Yeah, but I'm saying is the whole idea of that was to keep him in check.
Yep.
Until he invaded him, which was a big mistake.
Big mistake. Battlefront there in Russia. He wasn't Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great would have sat down and said, Dolph, I don't think so.
No. But you know what I'm saying.
He said, here's how we're going to do it. It's a good thing Alexander the Great didn't invade Russia because Joseph Stalin would have been history.
He would never have been there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. 31 says, and arms shall stand on his part, and they shall pollute the sanctuary of strength, and shall take away the daily sacrifices, and they shall place the abomination that maketh desolate. Here's what we're talking about from this little horn mentioned back over in chapter 8. Antiochus the Epiphanes the fourth is this one that shall stand and take and pollute the sanctuary. Okay? He is going to defile openly, willingly, on purpose. Hey, everybody, look here. I am going into the Jewish temple, and I am going to openly defile. Who is your God? There is no God. On and on and on. And offer, take all the sacrifices away that they've been doing to God. And then set up a statue of a false God, just like the Antichrist is going to do in Revelation 13 about himself. And the false prophet causes it to speak. Everybody will bow down to it. This man has already done it. Israel got to see it. And some of them were kind of cheering him on. But God says this is not going to go unpunished. So we're going to see what happens here. But this abomination of desolation, this is what Daniel talks about. This is what Matthew talks about. Jesus talks about in Matthew and the Gospels. This is what Paul talks about and all throughout Revelation. 32 says, and such as do wickedly against the covenant shall be corrupt by flatteries, but the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. Well, praise God for that verse right there. Daniel's on his knees, bowing, probably squirming, thinking, seeing all this going on. And then there's that little B12 shot again. Thank God for that. He does that every time. And such as do wickedly against the covenant. These are the people that he's talking about here. They worship him or die. That's what it turns out to be. He turns many Jews to self-preservation of instead of following our God. This man here who's in charge, and you see all these skirmishes that's been going on for year after year after year. This is what Israel is used to. They just say, well, we'll just follow this guy. So it's going to happen in the end times too. But thank God for that last part. But the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. So they're going to risk this. They're the Hasidian Jews, along with, if you remember from the Hasidian Jews and the Maccabees, these are the people who know that God is God. This is all part of his plan. They stay faithful to the God of heaven, the God of Israel, the God that is true, the God that is real, the God that they can run to, this Lord that they can run to and be safe. Like we just read in Proverbs 18:10. These are the ones where, and let me finish reading here. In 33 it says, and they that understand among the people shall instruct many, yet they shall fall by the sword and by flame, by captivity and by spoil many days. Now when they shall fall, they shall be helped with a little help. This is the Maccabees. But many shall cleave to them with flatteries, and some, in 35, of them of understanding shall fall to try them and to purge and to make them white even to the time of the end, because it is not yet, but because it is yet for a time appointed. So they're going through a refining time here, Bill. They're going through a time of terrible trouble, not yet the end time Jacob's trouble, but it certainly is trouble in Israel. So Antiochus comes against Jerusalem in 170 BC there in 31. 100,000 Jews are killed. Now imagine that, 100,000 plus Israelites, he kills them. And he stops their daily sacrifices. He erects an altar of Zeus, Jupiter, false god there, and offers swine's blood and broth on the altar. This is the abomination of desolation that we just read about in 31. So in Matthew 24, Jesus speaks of this Antiochus, of this Antichrist of the future, who will set up an image of himself, this man of lawlessness. And is our society, let me ask you, is our society ripe today for a man of lawlessness to stand up and say, I've got all the answers?
Oh yeah.
Absolutely. You can see it. It is ripe. It's, not just in this area, but worldwide.
Worldwide, yeah.
Worldwide. There's just aura, an evil, black, dark cloud of lawlessness going on. And the man of lawlessness is going to stand, the man of sin, the Antichrist, the one of a fierce countenance, the one of, with flatteries, is going to stand up and say, I've got this.
Well, I think in today, even today, Sam, I believe there are many, M-I-N-I, Antichrists on earth right now.
Absolutely. Oh, well, we're told that in the epistle of 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. We need to be careful and try the spirits. Why? Because there are, his spirit is already in the world.
Right.
Okay, this was 2,000 years ago when that was written.
Right.
So, right. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're out there plotting right now.
Absolutely. But it's leading to V. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure enough. So, for 2 Thessalonians 2, 3, and 4, this man of sin, this lawless one, Isaiah 14, 13 and 14, Ezekiel 28, 2 through 9. So no more Jewish sacrifices in the temple. He stops this, these oblations. He uses flattery. The Antichrist speaks nice words to them, and many, many of them are swayed to be loyal to him. Because why? It's more self-preservation going on. They see the power that be, and they go with him. They say, well, this is the guy in charge right now, so let's just, he's already told me, if I do this, if I stay in his realm, then he won't chop my head off. Okay, so the true followers of God, the Hasidian Jews there, they chose death over disloyalty. I think that's very commendable, to choose death over disloyalty. Yep. So this is coming soon in our future. This is coming, folks. This is coming in our future. There will be one that stands up, he and his false prophet, and Satan himself is going to be indwelt in this man. And he is going to stand up. It's going to be a system, but there's going to be a world-dominating dictator, a kingdom, his kingdom. It has to be a person that sits on it, because it talks about his kingdom and his throne of darkness. So, but notice there in 166 BC, the old Mattathias, the priest, this was a priest out of the temple, he came and raised, he was raised in the Maccabees, and he led a revolt against this wicked blasphemer. You can do that? You can stand up and say, that's not right, and I'm not going to go along with you. Yes, you can. And so I like his nickname. It was called the Hammer. The Hammer. And these were the strong men who know God and did exploits. They resisted evil. Resist the devil, we're told in the New Testament. Resist the devil and do what? What happens? He shall flee from you. Run to God. The closer you get to God, the further the devil stays from you. Because why? He can't stand the presence of the Holy One. Mm-hmm. Why did Proverbs tell us? The Lord, capital L-O-R-D, Jehovah, Jesus the Christ, the God has become our salvation. When we run to him, even though Satan's hot on our trails, when we get in his arms, can't get us, can't touch that. Okay? I believe that's a song, isn't it?
That's right.
Now then, Bill, just to be mean, I'm going to stop right there.
So you're stopping at which verse?
35.
35?
Because 36 on is well into the future, and
that's why I've got all that highlighted.
I want us to, it's good. I'm not even going to start reading it. It's so good. It's the power of the Northern King, and this stops now. This stops what Daniel's seeing in well into his future, and we've seen verses 2 through 35 happen in the past. Mm-hmm. We haven't seen 36 through 45, so I want to take that and start next week. Maybe just spend a whole section on that because it's talking about our future, 36 through 45, and I just want to stop right there because it's some interesting stuff. Talk about the Antichrist of the future. All right, y'all have a blessed day, a blessed week, and continue to run to the Lord. He is our strength.
Amen. Well, that was Daniel, chapter 11, verses 1 through 35. Well, I hope you enjoyed the study because there was a lot of information thrown out there, and that would be very interesting, and because it. It pertains to our future as well in regards to Revelation and Rapture and Armageddon. It just continues on, and there's still more to come after verse 35, beginning 36, we can get into some real heavy meat then. So anyway, hope you enjoyed our study. Anytime that you have a chance to go back and look at some of our other studies, they're all on my Facebook page and on my YouTube page, which is Billy D123, Mr. Billy D123. And if you want to look at me on Facebook, it's just Bill Dubois. You know, we go all the way back to February of 2020 on some of these studies. So, with that being said, we'll see you next week. May God bless the United States of America. May God bless our military and our first responders. Thank you very much, and we'll see you next week.